last session, we discussed the development of the torpedo boat, which of course went on until the beginning of World War One. In this session, we are going to cover the torpedo boat destroyer.
In our last session, we discussed the development of the torpedo boat, which of course went on until the beginning of World War One.
At the beginning of the 20th century. But before we launch onto the main topic of torpedo boat destroyers, I would like to mention briefly the torpedo gunboat, a much maligned class of vessel, which was a victim of the ultra-rapid development in warship design and particularly warship speed. The arrival of the first-class torpedo boat, i.e. those that were not carried on the decks of larger warships, built by Thornycroft for the Norwegian Navy in 1874, posed a real threat to one of the main planks of naval strategy, the blockade. The concern was that a fleet keeping station close to a coast whilst blockading a hostile harbour would be vulnerable to small, independent, fast-moving torpedo boats with a low profile attacking under the cover of darkness. As a defence against this threat, in 1885, the Admiralty invited the Director of Naval Construction, Sir Nathaniel Barnard, to produce a design which would be capable of intercepting such an attack. The vessel had to be capable of steaming with a fleet in a rough seaway, whilst having sufficient speed to intercept and destroy, but not necessarily chase, torpedo boats. The requirement became pressing during the Russian war scare of 1885. Indeed, the year before, in the Pall Mall Gazette, there had been a call for more torpedo-carrying craft. So, the first design was produced in 1885, and the vessel was launched in the following year as HMS Rattlesnake. In fact, the Admiralty had been considering the possibility of a small seagoing vessel armed with torpedoes and guns to accompany the fleet as early as 1880. Their thoughts were spurred on by the fact that the French developed a vessel, the Condor class, in 1883 for this purpose. Indeed, a paper was circulated discussing such a vessel and labelling it as a scout in 1881. This word scout points up the thinking of the Admiralty, since the term was traditionally applied to the fleet's cruisers, or light cruisers, since these were the eyes of the fleet. And what the Admiralty came up with was the concept of a very light cruiser with different capabilities and a speed faster than the then fleet steaming speed of 15 knots. This thinking was reversed in 1883 when Yarrow, a builder of torpedo boats on the River Thames, came up with a proposal to offer a scaled-up torpedo boat instead. Indeed, as you will remember from Paul Fontenoy's talk on torpedo boats at our last presentation, Thornycroft echoed this proposal in 1886 with TBs 48 and 53, both similar vessels, where the former was equipped for torpedo attack and the latter was given guns as opposed to torpedoes to hunt down its own kind. These alternative and commercially based proposals were, in due course, and along with other factors, destined to make the TGB redundant, mainly on account of its lack of speed. The other factor that would, in due course, have rendered it useless was the increase in fleet speed to in excess of 20 knots due to the introduction of the steam turbine into all fleet units. Had turbines been available at the time, and if the Admiralty had considered equipping the TGB with these engines, then it might have been able to continue in fleet service rather than being relegated to coastal duties such as minesweeping and target practice. Now, I will now give a brief outline of the four classes of torpedo gunboat, but before I do, I would like to consider a philosophical point. The Admiralty had, in the late 1870s, ordered what might be termed a torpedo ram. The arrival of steam propulsion had opened up the opportunity of sinking an opponent by ramming him. It was felt that such a vessel could also be equipped with torpedoes. Now, HMS Polyphemus was a one-off design, largely submerged, with adequate speed at the time to offer an attack to a major fleet unit, either by ram or by torpedo or both. The call for such a vessel shows the desire of the Royal Navy, at least to use the torpedo as a fleet weapon, as opposed to merely a harbour defence weapon. This desire enters into the specification of the TGB in that it was thought that it could have two roles, torpedo attack against an opposing fleet and the protection of its own fleet from such an attack. Dual roles usually call for heavier armament, and the case of the TGB, it had to carry guns and torpedoes to the detriment of its speed. So now to deal with the prototype and the four ensuing classes. HMS Rattlesnake was designed in 1885 and launched in the following year, by which time the next class, the Grasshopper class, had been designed and would be launched in 1887. Rattlesnake displaced 550 tons and was 200 feet overall. She was the first British warship to fit vertical triple expansion engines, developing 1,600 horsepower. She had a forced draft speed of 19.25 knots from two screws driven by two engines. Now, the forced draft concerns the draft applied to the boilers. Its first-class torpedo boats stage were reaching 23 knots by this time. She carried one 4-inch 25-pounder breech-loading gun, 6 3-pounder quick-firing guns, and 4 torpedo tubes, 2 fixed on the foredeck and 2 on swivel platforms on the main deck. She was armoured on the deck only with 3/4-inch steel. The Grasshopper class was virtually the same as the prototype and was given the same armament and propulsion. 3 of this class were built. They and the prototype Rattlesnake were all flush-decked, having no raised forecastle. They must have been very wet in a seaway, as the remaining 3 classes all had a raised forecastle. Speed was the same at 19 knots, but with a horsepower of 2,700. The large sharpshooter class were designed in 1888 by William White, and 13 were subsequently produced. They displaced more than the prototype, being 735 tons, with a length overall of 242 feet. Their machinery was similar to the earlier classes, with a horsepower of 2,500. An increased armament was provided of 2 4.7-inch breech-loading guns and 4 3-pounder quick-firing guns, with 5 torpedo tubes, 1 in the bow and 2 twin tubes either side on the main deck. This class was equipped with a forecastle, making for a drier ship. This builder's model, probably Armstrong, is worth examining. She has rather good lines with twin screws and bilge keels, altogether a lovely looking vessel. In this midship shot, you can see her 2 sets of twin torpedo tubes and the outboard boat's derricks, which rather spoil her good looks, as well as being difficult when coming alongside. Her bow detail shows the bow torpedo tube, the 4.7-inch gun, and the open bridge. And here is another shot of her bridge, another shot of midships, and finally a view of her stern, showing the aft 4.7-inch breech-loading gun and the twin torpedo tubes. Note the large propellers on the brackets, and here is a shot of HMS, or should it be HMAS, Boomerang, another example of the sharpshooter class. This class was followed by the Alarm class, which are really improved sharpshooters, with 2 4.7-inch guns, breech loaders, 4 3-pounder quick-firing guns, 1 machine gun, and 5 14-inch torpedo tubes in the first 5 of the class, and 3 18-inch torpedo tubes in the last 6. 11 of this class were launched between 1892 and 1894, one of them built by Thornycroft, to his own design, had 3 funnels instead of the normal 2, and was equipped with water tube boilers as opposed to locomotive boilers, and probably for that reason was able to achieve a speed of 20.55 knots, with a possible horsepower of 5,000. Now, I think it is worth comparing this particular vessel to the River or E-class torpedo boat destroyers, because although the TGB, as I have said, was much maligned, it was not all that different to the vessels that followed the ridiculously fast torpedo boat destroyers, the River class of 1902. which came from a desire of naval officers for a more seaworthy version of the torpedo boat destroyer, and with a raised forecastle to give a better performance in a high sea, albeit accepting a reduction in speed from 33 knots, which the TBDs could do, to 25 knots. So the contention is that the torpedo gunboat is significant to the development of the destroyer proper. The final class ordered in 1891 was the dryad class. It not only had a raised forecastle deck, but also a raised quarterdeck, making for an ungainly looking vessel with a heavier displacement of 1,070 tons and a length overall of 262 feet. It was only capable of achieving 18 knots, having only 3,500 horsepower. By this time, torpedo boats were achieving 23 knots, and the TBDs capable of 27 knots were also beginning to appear. The TGB was on its way out. The Royal Navy built 33 of these vessels for its own use, whilst the commercial yards, which built some of the boats, produced another 11 for other nations' navies. Here is a model of Almirante Simpson for the Chilean Navy, supplied by Laird of Birkenhead. Argentina, Brazil, Ecuador, Uruguay, and Japan all had torpedo gunboats from Laird of Birkenhead and Armstrong of Elswick. Thompson of Clydebank supplied a vessel to Spain that has been described as the first destroyer, the Destructor. It is difficult to say whether this vessel fits into the description of a gunboat or a torpedo boat destroyer. To my mind, it should be the latter, as she is very well set up for guns of the right size and type for shooting at torpedo boats. One 90mm Ontario gun forward, five 57mm Nordenfeldt quick-firing guns, and two 37mm Hotchkiss cannons. She also had three torpedo tubes, two let into her bow and one above her rudder. A senior officer of the Spanish naval staff, Fernando Villamil, was instrumental in drawing up this design and has been credited, rightly or wrongly, with starting the great worldwide line of the destroyer class. The Austro-Hungarians had a large fleet of these vessels and built most of them at Trieste and Pola, but several were supplied by Sickau, Germany. One of which was Magnet, as shown in this 1,700 model made by a member of our society. They also had, in the Austro-Hungarian Navy, a Palmer's boat at Yarrow. This was SMS Planet, again a model by one of our members. A brief review of the numbers held by the major navy is as follows. Great Britain, 33, France, 15, Japan, 5, Austro-Hungary, 11, Russia, 12, China, 6, Sweden, 5, Spain, 11, Germany, 0. These ships clearly had their uses and continued to serve in various guises up until the beginning of the First World War. I will now hand you over to Paul Fontenoy, we'll talk to you about the torpedo boat destroyer.
As torpedo boats and their torpedoes became more capable with greater range and higher speeds, the need for effective counters became pressing. Initial efforts in the 1880s took two paths. Torpedo gunboats, essentially small, fast cruisers that Ian has discussed, or more heavily armed torpedo boats. Prime examples of this approach were the British 125-footer and the Italian torpediniere avviso classes, neither of which proved very effective. They were no faster than contemporary torpedo boats and could only carry 3-pounder or 5-centimeter guns, but they did point the way towards a possible solution. A successful solution necessitated integrating three essential requirements: speed superior to that of torpedo boats, armament of equivalent caliber to that deployed aboard battleships against torpedo boats, and adequate range to accompany the fleet. When Jackie Fisher became controller of the Navy as Third Sea Lord, he involved himself in ongoing Admiralty discussions with the two leading British torpedo boat builders, Thornycroft and Yarrow, concerning this problem, leading to contracts for two experimental vessels from each yard of a new type, the torpedo boat destroyer. Incidentally, if you read Lady Yarrow's biography of Alfred Yarrow, you'd believe that Thornycroft had absolutely nothing to do with it, but she was a little bit biased. I must note at this point that other yards, notably J. Samuel White, contemporaneously had suggested solutions somewhat similar to the eventual outcome, but the solution generated by the Fisher-Thornycroft-Yarrow combination prevailed. The new torpedo boat destroyer was essentially a greatly enlarged torpedo boat. Displacement was doubled from about 135 tons to 275 tons, and the greater displacement allowed for more powerful machinery, which boosted speed from 23 knots to 26 knots. It also permitted increasing armament from 3 3-pounders to 1 12-pounder and 3 to 5 6-pounders, depending upon whether the two rotating 18-inch torpedo tubes were carried or not. Greater range also conferred adequate range to work with the fleet and marginally improved seakeeping qualities. The first torpedo boat destroyer was completed as HMS Havoc in January 1894. Unlike the five other so-called 26-knotters, two others had been ordered from Laird in January of 1893, Havoc used locomotive boilers rather than the water tube boilers. You'll see that the funnels are really, really close together. The Admiralty actually specified a trial speed of 27 knots, but tacitly agreed to accept 26 knots without penalties, since the boats were experimental. In the event, all six boats attained 27 knots on trials, with one, Thornycroft's Daring, slightly exceeding 28 knots. The Admiralty was remarkably confident of the success of this new type. In July 1893, 6 months before Havoc's completion, it called for tenders for three more boats each from Yarrow and Thornycroft, but eliminated the waiver for speed shortfall. The next month, it invited tenders from 12 more firms, most of which had limited or no experience of building high-speed lightweight warships, for another 30 boats, for a total of 36 so-called 27-knotters, all contracted by November 1893, before Havoc's even been in service. The Admiralty gave the builders considerable design latitude, both in hull form and power plant. Consequently, boats had ram, plumb, or raking bows, and considerably different sterns too. One consistent feature of their hulls was the use of turtleback forecastles. Builders fitted locomotive boilers or one of several different types of water tube boilers. So externally, boats presented from 1 to 4 funnels in various configurations. You can see this variety here. Since most of the builders had limited experience in building torpedo craft, the Admiralty provided substantial technical assistance by distributing information about lightweight construction techniques for both structure and machinery from the specialist firms. Although the Admiralty claimed its right to do so was within the contract with the specialists, this provoked quite a row with Alfred Yarrow, who strongly objected to the release of his long-term and expensive work in these areas to potential competitors. As a result, Yarrow declined to tender for Admiralty work for the next 10 years. A further incentive may have been the fact that his yard was full of foreign contracted orders that had a 20% profit margin versus the 7% permitted by the Admiralty. Over the next 6 years, the Admiralty contracted for 66 additional boats, all somewhat larger and designed to attain 30 knots, hence their common designation as 30-knotters. In addition, there were three specials contracted to reach 32 to 33 knots. Once again, builders received wide design latitude, though all opted to use water tube boilers. So they still continued to exist many external variations in appearance, with 2 to 4 funnels in various configurations. Ultimately, the Admiralty decided on a rather crude classification system for these TBDs, designating the 26 and 27 knotters the A class, the 30 knotters with 4 funnels as the B class, those with 3 as the C class, and those with 2 as the D class. Not all of these boats achieved their contract speeds on trial. And this, together with multiple machinery breakdowns, indicated that these boats demonstrated that they were reaching the limit of what warship speeds were attainable using triple expansion engines. Accordingly, the Admiralty accepted proposals from Parsons for three turbine engine vessels, Parsons supplying the machinery and subcontracting the hulls to various shipyards. Nick will be discussing machinery development in much more detail in the next section of this presentation. When the first British torpedo boat destroyers emerged, France had been working on a very similar concept for much the same period. Normand developed a 300-ton design that was an enlargement of his earlier torpedo de haute mer series. Like the British boats, the contre-torpedo's displacement was double that of its precursor, and it carried a much heavier gun armament of 165mm and 647mm weapons, rather than the 247mm guns of the torpedoes. France ordered 55 of these 300-ton type between 1896 and 1904 from private yards and naval dockyards. It all used water tube boilers and triple expansion engines to attain 26 to 28 knots. Externally, all were very similar, apart from the four boats of the Frame class, which had four boilers and four funnels instead of the two used by all the others. The Reichsmarine followed a rather different pattern of development. Between 1888 and 1894, Schickau had built a small series of nine division boats that were enlarged versions of the fleet's torpedo boats and ranged from 295 to 451 tons. And with substantially the same performance and armament, 23 knots, three torpedo tubes, and 3 5-centimeter guns. Incidentally, the Germans called them 5-centimeter guns, but they were actually 52 millimeters. Don't ask me, I just go by what the book says. These division boats were designed to act as leaders for torpedo boat flotillas. The extra displacement accommodating necessary command staff, but did not enhance the flotilla's fighting power. In 1896, a contract was signed with Thornycroft for a 30-knotter similar to those of the Royal Navy as a division boat, D-10, carrying three torpedo tubes and 5 5-centimeter guns. Simultaneously, Schickau was developing a faster boat version of its final division boat, D-9, with displacement increased from 250 to 310 tons. To permit installing 5,680 horsepower machinery in place of the 4,200 horsepower engines, raising speed to almost 28 knots. Armament, however, remained unchanged. Strangely, the prototype for these improved designs were four boats for the Imperial Chinese Navy with turtleback forecastles. These boats all were captured at Taku during the Boxer Rebellion and were distributed to the British, French, German, and Russian navies as prizes, and they were all renamed Taku. The production boats for the Reichsmarine differed in having raised forecastles with the bridge moved aft to create a well ahead of it, in which one torpedo tube was mounted. Although most foreign observers classified this design as a torpedo boat destroyer, the Reichsmarine called it a Hochsee torpedo boat, and the tactical instructions for the use of such boats placed primary emphasis on torpedo attack, with defense against enemy torpedo craft very much a secondary role. As had been the case with torpedo boats, most other fleets, with the exception of the US Navy, relied on purchasing their torpedo boat destroyers from British, French, or German yards, or building to their designs under license. The two largest such fleets were the Imperial Russian and the Imperial Japanese navies. Russia purchased boats from Laird and Yarrow in Britain, Schickau in Germany, and Normand designed 300-ton boats from France and built large numbers of duplicates of all these designs in its own shipyards for service in the Baltic, Black Sea, and Pacific fleets. This model that you just saw was by another one of Jim Bauman's 1 to 700 scale models. The Navy classified all these vessels as torpedo boats until 1907, when the survivors were designated destroyers. This is a French one. and again another one of Jim's models. Researching these Russian boats demands great care, since the Navy renamed all of them from fish and bird names to action names in 1902. For example, the first destroyer, Sokol, which means falcon, became Pritki, meaning preventer, so that it's all too easy to become confused. Japan relied exclusively on products from Yarrow and Thordicraft, or indigenous iterations of these designs. The six Ikazuki class and the two Akatsuki class were basically standard Yarrow export designs of the 30-knot type. And the six Murakumo class were virtual repeats of Thornycroft's 30-knotters. The 30-knotter is the one up in the top left. The two Shirakumos were an enlarged Thornycroft design with an extra boiler, giving them a maximum speed of 31 knots, while the last of the series, the seven Harusame-class boats, were an indigenous enlargement of the Shirakumo design. Italy, too, relied on imports or imported designs. Its first cacciatorpediniere, Fulmine, was an almost exact replica of the 30-knotted design by Palmer, although the Ufficio Storico attributes it to the naval engineer Ernesto Martinez. It appears that Palmer had sold the drawings to Italy, in fact. Schickau supplied the six Lampo-class boats, which was similar to the Reichsmarine examples, but with the bridge positioned immediately abaft the forecastle. Patterson, a Thornycroft subsidiary, built six boats of the Nembo class, essentially identical to the British D-class boats. And finally, Ansaldo built 10 boats of the Bersaglieri class, which were similar to the Nembos, but with a separate funnel for each boiler. Laird, Thornycroft and Yarrow, Schickau in Germany and Normandy, France, delivered destroyers to many other lesser navies. In Sweden, there was a direct competition between Yarrow's Mode, similar to Ikazuki for Japan, and Thornycroft's Magne, identical to Japan's Shirakumo. The Magne design prevailed, and Sweden built six duplicates locally, which remained in service until after World War II. The Ikazuki design was a success elsewhere. It initially developed from the design for the Corrientes for Argentina. It was also used for the Imperial and Royal Navy's Hussar class of 13 boats. The survivors from World War I were distributed as reparations to France, Italy, and Greece. This is another one of Jim Bauman's models, by the way. Again, 1:700 scale. The Italians and French scrapped theirs, but Greece commissioned Ulan as Smyrni and kept it in service until 1932. There was also one remarkable export oddity. China sought to purchase destroyers for its fleet in 1911, either because of their brilliant salesmanship or because they offered lower prices than any other yards. An order was placed for one destroyer each from Ansaldo in Italy and Stabilimento Tecnico Trieste in Austria-Hungary. In the event, although both boats were completed and successfully ran trials, neither was delivered before the outbreak of World War I because of Chinese delays in making final payments. Ansaldo's boat entered the Regia Marina as Ascaro of the Bersaglieri class and STT's, the Austro-Hungarian fleet, as Vorondina of the Hussar class. Despite its predominance as a design feature of destroyers everywhere but in Germany, the turtleback forecastle significantly limited sea-keeping qualities of torpedo boat destroyers. Furthermore, most navies eventually realized that the high speeds attained on trials did not correspond to operational speeds at sea. When the Admiralty came to consider designs for TBDs of the 1901-1902 program, it decided to emphasize sturdiness and sea-keeping over top speed in ideal conditions. The result was the River class, with, for the first time on Royal Navy torpedo craft, a raised forecastle, a higher bridge, and a more realistic speed requirement to maintain 25 knots. It also has probably some influence from British officers observing the German torpedo boats. This class set the pattern for the Royal Navy's destroyer design for the next 40 years. As delivered, the River class was armed, like earlier TBDs, with one 12-pounder and five 6-pounders. Information from the Russo-Japanese War indicated that the 6-pounders were ineffective, so many of the class received an additional three 12-pounders in place of their 6-pounders, emphasizing the anti-ship role of British destroyers. The Russian fleet came to a similar conclusion. All its destroyers ordered from 1903 onwards, before the Russo-Japanese War, either locally or abroad, had raised forecastles and heavier gun armament.
I'm going to look briefly at the machinery that was used in early torpedo boats and destroyers. I'll be speaking in very generic terms, only referring to specific examples to illustrate my points. I'm sure it goes without saying that members will realise that the early days of powered vessels, any machine that would cause the boat to move without the aid of sails or oars would have done the trick. It wasn't really until the middle of the 19th century that thought started to be given to producing machinery specifically for warships. As I was saying earlier, I work as a volunteer on the Warrior, so I've chosen this ship specifically to illustrate a point. When the Warrior was built, the engine designer, John Penns, he decided that the important criteria was that the engine needed to be below the waterline. And therefore, the water outside the hull would act as some kind of cushion against any incoming shot from an enemy vessel to protect the vital bit of the ship, i.e. the engine. So therefore, the engine on the Warrior is slightly strange in as much as it's a horizontal engine. This is not a practice that would normally be carried out in merchant ship practice, whereby the cylinders of the steam engine would almost certainly be vertical, largely because that's the most mechanically efficient way of doing it. In order to get the engine as low as possible, it was decided that the cylinders had to be horizontal in the case of the Warrior. Also, in the case of a warship, then cost doesn't seem to be anywhere near as important as it would be to a merchant ship company that would obviously have to make a profit. And therefore, they could adopt some practices which wouldn't be common in merchant service, such as they would use metal sealing stroke scraper rings inside the cylinders. The piston is sealed inside the cylinder. It's a slightly loose fit, and to make certain you don't get a lot of steam oozing out around the side of your piston, you normally have some kind of packing around it to seal the gap between the piston and the cylinder. For cheapness on a merchant ship, this would probably be oiled hemp. On a warship, particularly the Warrior, this was made of metal. The other thing, of course, is if you look in any cruise brochure, you will notice that most cruise companies sell their cruises back to back. It's probably months or even years before the ship actually is taken out of service for any length of time to have any major work done it. Whereas, all due respect to the Royal Navy, I was looking today, HMS Queen Elizabeth has been in Portsmouth for something like 2 months, and the Prince of Wales has been there now for well over a week. They've got plenty of time to do maintenance on their ship. The Warrior, in actual fact, is quite an interesting example, in as much that one of the problems you have with marine machinery, as opposed to, say, railway locomotive machinery, is that you are limited with the amount of fresh water you have. It sounds bizarre that you have water everywhere, but it's not the right sort of water. and therefore you have to reuse your water, unlike a railway locomotive, which was probably just squirted up the smokestack or out the sides. A warship will actually have to continuously reuse its water, and ideally that should be fresh water. On the Warrior, the used steam is converted back into water simply by squirting a certain amount of seawater into the condenser. This is obviously cold and instantly condenses the steam back into water, and it goes back around the system again, the boiler, the engine, the condenser, and round and round and round and round. But if you're injecting seawater into this, it's slowly becoming more and more saline, of course. So therefore, you have a bit of a problem because salt water will quickly corrode your engine. It will also mean you have to have far bigger tolerances when making your engine, simply because you get so much muck in the engine coming through from the seawater. And of course, you have to keep shutting down your boilers so you can get a little man in there with his chipping hammer to hammer away at the salt inside the boilers. But it is worth us moving on. That's interesting. I've forgotten that image at the top there was a moving one of the Warrior's engine actually working. Believe me, this hasn't happened for some time, and it's a very sore point amongst the volunteers who work on board. But this is the speed that it normally does, and it's slow ahead. And you can see that it is actually rotating really quite slowly. Anyway, so moving on then. I've chosen as an example of machinery towards the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, the Greek battleship, and the Greeks refer to it as a battleship, the Georgios Averof, which is very well preserved at Piraeus near Athens, and you cannot go down the engine room. So I'm not prepared to answer any questions as to how I got that picture in the top left-hand corner there. But basically, by the end of the century, certainly from about the 1890s onwards, then steam pressures had become much higher. That was possible because the condensers had been redesigned, and we'll have another look at condensers a bit later on, so I won't go into the design of them at the moment. But by the end of the century, you could now have boiler pressures which were probably in the region of 170, 180 psi, something like that. And when you get steam at that sort of pressure, you can not only blow it into your engine in the conventional manner and push the piston around, but even when the steam comes out of that piston, it's still got a lot of energy in it. So you can inject it into another cylinder and then onto a third, and very occasionally even onto a fourth cylinder. And in each one, it expands as it goes, and you are getting more and more power from your steam, making more and more use of it as it goes through before you send it back to the condenser. And I particularly like this picture of the engine room of the Georgios Averof here. It's not instantly apparent, but if you look very carefully in this area here, you can see a bulkhead. And this is a centerline bulkhead, this being the starboard engine of the ship. Now, this ship was built in Italy, and this is Italian practice, whereby you have a centerline bulkhead. Some other countries did it as well. It most certainly wasn't British practice. The theory of a centerline bulkhead was basically, if you've got a hole in the side of your ship here, this area may well flood, but you've got another engine on the other side of that bulkhead, and you can still carry on with that. What they seem to have overlooked, and what certainly worried the British naval architects, was the fact that if you flooded a massive, great big space like an engine room on one side of the ship, almost certainly the ship would capsize. So therefore, British theory was that it was far better to allow both engine rooms to flood and risk losing power and hope you might get help from another passing ship, rather than allow your ship to capsize. So moving on to torpedo boats initially, and this is my model of the Austro-Hungarian torpedo boat, the Viper. The problem here was you now needed to get a lot of power to make these things go fast into a small, light hull. So therefore, you couldn't have a sunken great big engine such as we've just seen in the Georgia Savarov. You had to be able to get something that was several hundred horsepower. In the case of this vessel, it was 1,900 horsepower into a very small hull, and you had to be able to get high speed out of doing it. So if we move on to an actual engine, this is once again a Austro-Hungarian example. This is an engine which has been preserved in the Technical Museum in Vienna, and it's the engine from the Austro-Hungarian torpedo boat, the Vaia. And I particularly like this one because it shows simple construction. You can see, if I can find the cursor, there we go. You can see the three separate cylinders. So high pressure steam would have gone into here, come out of here into the center piston, and then into the large one at the end here, before finally being exhausted out to the condenser. But I draw your attention in particular to the very light, flimsy looking construction of these things for torpedo boats. This was something that would have been unique to a torpedo boat or destroyer. A larger ship would almost certainly have far more massive chunks of metal supporting it. And the only way of getting very high power out of a flimsily built, thin, framed engine was really to run it at very high speed. And speeds of between 350 and 400 revs a minute were not at all unusual for vessels of this kind. And do you think what that actually means for a piston engine? The poor old piston has got to change direction twice for every revolution of the engine, once at the top and once at the bottom. So if you're doing 400 revs a minute, the poor old piston has got to change direction 800 times a minute. So vibration is absolutely critical of these things. Otherwise, they'll just tear themselves to bits. And I did come across several examples of these things needing to be balanced. And you get the captain speaking to the chief engineer and saying, I think you need to go and rebalance your engine, chief. And the chief would do bizarre things. He would go and stick a coin on the big end bearing or something like that to go and balance his engine. Or he'd literally go down there with his nail file and he'd take off half a millimeter of the balance weight. Or anything like that to try and rebalance this engine. If he didn't get that right, there was a very severe risk of the engine shaking itself to bits and possibly bits flying out through the side of the torpedo boat and even sinking the torpedo boat. So this is an example towards the end of the 19th century. The Vaia was built in 1888. But I was saying earlier about the difference really between a ship's engine and a railway locomotive engine. And in deference to our American members, you'll be pleased to see that I've chosen an American locomotive to illustrate the point, whereby the fresh water is used in the engine, drives the pistons backwards and forwards, and then it's chucked out the side or up the smokestack. I like this picture because just at the right of it, there is this water tower, and a railway locomotive would be able to take on fresh water at a very regular basis. Not more than a mile from where I sit at this very moment, we have the Isle of Wight Steam Railway. I live and ride on the Isle of Wight, and just off the coast of southern England. And I noticed that their locomotives take on fresh water about every 10 miles. So that's not very far. As I was saying, one of the big problems with marine engines is you've got water everywhere, but not a drop to stick in your boiler. So the right-hand picture here is a picture I took in the Deutsches Museum in Munich, and it's the engine of their first torpedo boat stroke destroyer. And Paul was saying earlier that to us Anglophones, the German distinction between a torpedo boat and a destroyer is utterly ambiguous. And if you can work it out, well, good luck to you, is all I can say. But this engine comes from the German destroyer S1. And once again, it's beautifully preserved. And I've chosen this because it amply illustrates the condenser stuck on the side of it. And very helpfully, they've taken the end plate off so that we can see all these tubes inside, which would be made of either copper or sometimes brass. And the principle here is that the steam, used steam from the engine, comes out of these exhaust pipes into the condenser, this massive great barrel here, through which are hundreds, literally hundreds, of these pipes. You pass your seawater through these pipes, so therefore that cools the pipe and not the steam. And your steam blows down over the top of these pipes, condensing as it goes, and it comes out the bottom as water. It hasn't been in contact with seawater, so therefore it shouldn't be becoming more saline as it goes round and round and round. And therefore, in theory, apart from the small amount of steam that you might blast up your funnel, your smokestack, to act as a drawer on the firebox, then you shouldn't be losing all your fresh water as you're going around. We were saying earlier that one of the great problems with a piston engine is the fact that you've got all these moving parts thundering up and down, the pistons changing direction, anything up to 800 times a minute. And because of that, your speed of a torpedo boat's destroyer is limited around about 27 knots, give or take a little bit one way or another. If you try and go much faster than that, you are risking the whole engine just completely disintegrating on you and, say, flying to bits, and even your big end bearing or whatever it might be going smashing out through the side of the boat and sinking the boat. It has happened, believe me. So therefore, you need an engine which has not got so many parts changing direction all the time. You really want something that is running continuously and smoothly. And the answer was obviously the turbine engine, arguably invented by Charles Parsons. Now, if you ask a dozen historians to tell you the story of the turbine, they will probably give you a dozen different explanations. But my explanation, which I think is probably about the most logical one, is that the Navy was hidebound. And I'm talking about the British Navy here in particular. Justifiably so, I have to say, because don't forget they were working with public money. And therefore, they couldn't very well go to the Chancellor of the Exchequer, who controls the purse strings for the British government, and say, can we have a load of money to go and stick some new technology in one of our boats that we don't know whether it would work or not, because they probably wouldn't get it in the first place. And if they did and it all went wrong, they then got to go back to 11 Downing Street where the Chancellor lives, bang on his door and say, excuse me, all that money you gave us, we've just sent it to the bottom of the sea. So justifiably, they were hidebound and they were reluctant to try new technology. But nevertheless, my theory is that the Director of Naval Construction, who we were speaking about earlier, a certain William White, got to know or was good friends with Charles Parsons and said, look, we need to prove that this is going to work, mate. What I'll do is I will arrange for you to be able to sneak your new boat called the Turbina through the review of the fleet when all Her Majesty's ships will be lined up with Her Majesty standing there watching what's going on, and you thunder up and down like greased lightning and make a complete monkey out of everything that the Navy's got. And Parsons appears to have agreed with this and got his boat, the Turbina, which had his new turbines in producing 2,100 horsepower. And he could quite literally thunder up and down the lines of anchored battleships being chased by the Navy's fastest torpedo boats. And he could do 34 and a half knots, and the torpedo boats was lingering along behind at about 27 knots, if that. There are a number of problems with the turbine, one of which is that it has a voracious appetite for steam. And If we move on to the slide here, this is my model of HMS Velux, one of the very early turbine destroyers for the Royal Navy. Once Charles Parsons had made this the monkey out of the Royal Navy by charging up and down through the review of the fleet, 1897, the Navy sat up and took notice, and it said, okay, well, we need some of these then. So it ordered a torpedo boat called HMS Viper. Previously, we were talking about the Austrian ship of the same name, but this was a British one, HMS Viper, which very unfortunately ended up on the rocks off Alderney very soon after being commissioned. So very little data was obtained from her. She was followed by the purchase of a another torpedo, but another turbine destroyer, I suppose you would call it, HMS Cobra, which was being built as a private venture, but nevertheless, the Navy bought it outright. She broke in half on her delivery voyage, I believe. So once again, very little data was obtained from her either. So in desperation, the Navy then bought a private venture, which they named HMS Velux, this destroyer, which was being built between Charles Parsons, who made the engines, and Hawthorne Leslie, who built the hull. And hoping that you can see the diagram of the engine arrangement down here in the bottom left-hand corner, I may have to move my screen about, there we go. These are the turbine engines, but as I was saying, the biggest problem with turbine engines is they have this ferocious appetite for steam. Now this ship could actually do 34.5 knots, the same as their turbine. But in practice, to do that, she had to have a double crew of stokers shoveling away in the poor old stokehold as fast as they possibly could to be able to get enough steam to run these things for a comparatively short period of time so that the ship could actually do 34.5 knots. Nevertheless, Parsons was not arrogant to assume that that would be all right, so he therefore fitted these cruising engines, which were conventional piston engines, and these alone would produce about 15 knots, so drive the boat at about 15 knots, which were far more economical, and therefore it was practical to use this boat as a warship as opposed to just a pure test vessel. It's only when she needed to run at very high speed that she would use her turbines, and in practice with a single crew of stokers you could probably get 30 knots out of it as opposed to the 34.5 knots on test. Another problem with the turbine is that it runs extremely fast. Now, to a certain extent, the principle is the faster you turn your propeller, then the faster the boat will go. But there is a limit to that. If you try to overdo it, you effectively get cavitation, which you can see quite well in this photograph here, which was taken by somebody who looks remarkably like me, but who's going to remain nameless. I'm not going to say where I got this picture from either. And what is actually happening here is that the pressure is dropping on the leading face of the blades. And as pressure drops, as any mountaineer will tell you, has tried to make a cup of tea on the top of a mountain, then water boils at a lower temperature. And effectively, you've got steam here. And you're running your propeller faster and faster and faster, and it's just thrashing about in steam. So in other words, it's not giving any thrust. And you can get to the bizarre situation of the faster you turn your propeller, the slower your boat goes. So bizarrely, there were a number of attempts to try and overcome this. And things that we may consider to be bizarre today, but if you ask your great-grandfather, he would consider it to be perfectly reasonable. On the Velux, they tried various things like fitting more than one propeller per shaft, anything up to three on one occasion, in actual fact. The theory being that if you had three small propellers on a shaft rather than one big one, the diameter would be much smaller, and therefore the tips of the blades would be going round, would be actually moving at a slower rate than if you had one big propeller there. The other obvious solution is to make a gearbox. And I've chosen this picture, which I took on board HMS Belfast, now moored in the Pool of London, showing a typical gearbox from, I was going to say a warship, but probably any ship in actual fact. Now, any of us who are into model engineering would probably go a whiter shade of pale at the thought of having to make one of these things. In order to be able to distribute the load from your drive shaft from the turbine, this one here, to a much larger gear on the propeller shaft, which would run through here, then the best way of doing it is to have these wonderful helical gears rather than simple tooth gears, which, because of the power you are talking about, would almost certainly be stripped very easily. The thought of us model engineers trying to make any of these things would decidedly put us off. I think we'll probably take up origami or something. Not only that, the helical gear will produce a longitudinal thrust, so it will try and drive the shaft out of the gearbox down this end and bung it out through the back end of your gearbox. So to counter the longitudinal thrust, you need two of these, one left hand and one right hand, both driving on the same receiving cog, I suppose you might want to call it, wheel on the propeller shaft. These things were extremely difficult to make, and the first reference I could find to a gearbox being fitted to a destroyer was the USS Wadsworth in 1915. The problem wasn't so acute for larger ships, and this takes a bit of logical thinking, but you think, well, what in the turbine is going fast? And of course, it's the blade. Now, in a torpedo boat or a destroyer, you've got very little space, so you've got a very small engine, and therefore you've got a small diameter turbine disc with the blades on it. And therefore, a high-speed blade will have to turn the turbine, the rotor, very fast. On a much larger ship, whereby you could have a much larger turbine disc, then the blade is still going fast. So it might be doing several hundred miles an hour or what have you. But on the other hand, the turbine disc is not rotating so fast. I'll leave you to think about the logic of that one. It doesn't have to spin quite so fast for the blades at the tips to actually turn at the same speed. And therefore, the problem of fitting gearboxes to larger vessels wasn't addressed anywhere near as early. And the earliest large ships for the Royal Navy to have a gearbox were the light battle cruisers Courageous and Glorious of 1917. It's interesting, in actual fact, I was reading about the SS France not so long ago. And she had steam electric propulsion. So in other words, the turbines drove a generator and the propeller shaft was actually turned by electric motors. Common practice today, but it was innovative in the 1930s when this was first introduced. In fact, I think it was the late 1920s. But it was another way of reducing the speed of the propeller from that of the turbine. And very briefly, you'll be very pleased to hear, getting towards the end of my talk, is the methods that you need to raise the steam. This is an early simple boiler, whereby you basically have a sunken great big tank, and you normally have a firebox at one end. This looks as though it's probably oil fired, and you would probably have a firebox at the other end. And the hot combustion gases travel through these pipes inside your barrel. This would almost certainly be full of water, probably up to about sort of this level somewhere. And the heat is then transferred through these pipes to the water, which then boils, and it's taken off at the top. This is, the area here would be known as the steam chest, and there'll be a pipe coming out the top there going off to the engine. That was all very well, but this is quite a heavy construction. Yeah, apart from anything else, it's full of water, therefore water is heavy. So it's not the ideal sort of boiler to put in a torpedo boat or a destroyer. So eventually, and I'm sorry, I didn't actually look up to see when this particularly came into play, the idea of reversing the system came into play. And here we have an example of a water tube boiler. In this one, the fire would be outside the tubes, and the water is inside these tubes. By having a lot of these tubes, and there are probably several hundred in this particular boiler, then you have a very large heating service for the amount of water you are trying to heat, and therefore is far more efficient. And not only that, the boiler itself is much lighter. So in a torpedo boat or destroyer, you are able to produce quite a lot of steam very rapidly without having to have a particular heavy boiler in there. Interesting enough, this one, the much later version, it's got a superheater on the end, whereby your steam is taken out of the boiler and it's reheated again to dry it and make it into an even higher pressure. So there you go. So that is my brief rundown of basic machinery for torpedo boats and destroyers. So thank you very much for listening.
The performance of the Whitehead torpedo and of the boats that launched it during the decade 1800 to 1890. At the beginning of the decade, these weapons were being built at Fiume, the home port for Whitehead, and at Weymouth under the watchful eye of the Royal Navy. By the middle of the decade, their performance was 23.5 knots, but they had a range of only 600 yards, being driven by a Brotherton three-cylinder engine, which itself was driven by compressed air, not as yet heated. Whilst the running depth had been stabilized by 1868, the directional stability most certainly had not. And this would not occur until the middle of the 1890s, when Aubrey was able, in consultation with Whitehead, to introduce the use of the gyro compass, a long forgotten invention, of which no initial use was made. Thus in 1885, to mount a successful attack, the torpedo boat would have had to approach close to its target, and this could only be done under favorable weather conditions and under cover of darkness. By 1885, when the first torpedo gunboats were being built, both Yarrow and Thornycroft were producing torpedo boats capable of 23 knots and more. Although the approach to within 600 yards of the target at this speed would be a suicidal enterprise, as there would have been a complete loss of surprise, rendering them vulnerable to intercepting fire. And in due course, once ships were equipped with electricity, searchlight illumination. The speed available would, however, be most useful for a fast escape. In the decade following the 1890s, not only was directional stability achieved, but the maximum range rose to over 1,000 yards and the speed increased. This, the increasing speed of torpedo boats and the arrival of the TBDs and the introduction by the French of the torpilleur de mer, a larger, faster offshore vessel, forced the navies of the world to consider the threat posed to trade as well as the fleet, and therefore to be able to chase torpedo boats rather than intercept them, as the torpedo gunboats had been designed to do. And that is important because it's part of the reason for the introduction of the torpedo boat destroyer. And it was this fast ocean-going French torpedo boat. Now, these factors, as already been mentioned, and the increasing speed of the fleet post in 1906 spelled the demise of the torpedo gunboat, although in part it did affect the development of the destroyer.